Okay, so I hope you can hear me, right? You hear me? At least any one of you, just give me a feedback.
Yes.
Okay.
Yes, Manu.
Yeah, we can hear you.
Perfect. Okay, so let us start today. And to start, actually, I will invite Dr. Madhulika Rai. She is now a postdoctoral researcher in the USA. She is also one of the convener of March for Science Abroad, chapter abroad. So, Dr. Madhulika, can you please switch on your video and start the program?
Yes.
Yes.
Can you guys hear me?
I can hear you.
Okay. So, first of all, on behalf of India March for Science Chapter Abroad, I welcome you to our webinar on Science in Ancient India, Reality versus Myth by Professor Soumitra Banerjee. Now, there are about 2,200 people participating in this webinar, and we have hundreds of Indian scholars joining us from all over the globe, starting from American continent, for example, Canada, United States of America, Brazil, Mexico, etc. Also European continent, for example, UK, Germany, France, Spain, Italy, Hungary, Poland, Croatia, Israel, etc. And Southeast Asian continent, Australia, Taiwan, Japan, Malaysia, Philippines, etc. Now we have also hundreds of participants joining from India as well. We must acknowledge the efforts by Breakthrough Science Society for bringing this webinar to thousands of common people. It would not have been possible without their direct association and collaboration. Now, let me say a few words about the speaker today, Professor Soumitra Banerjee. Dr. Banerjee is a Shanti Swarup Bhatnagar awarded scientist and a highly respected professor in the Indian Institute of Science Education and Research, ICER Kolkata. He's also the General Secretary of a leading science organization in India, the Breakthrough Science Society. He's also one of the main leaders of India March for Science and the science movement in India. Now, we are very happy that Professor Banerjee is with us today for the webinar. Unfortunately, due to technical complications with the internet connection in this COVID-19 time, we shall play the record for his talk to avoid disturbance, which may appear due to bad internet connection. But he's online with us for the entire session and will take the questions at the end. And the talk will be for 55 minutes. The webinar is now streamed live on the YouTube channel and the Facebook page of the Breakthrough Science Society. Before we start, I request all of you on Zoom to kindly mute your microphone and switch off your video during the talk. Please note, we shall accept questions only at the end of the talk. And after the talk, you switch on your video, but keep your microphone on mute mode. Unmute your microphone only when you ask questions. And for those who are participating in the webinar on YouTube or Facebook, you can write your questions there on the chat box. Our moderator will pass these questions to the speaker for answers and discussions. And with this, let us start the webinar, and thank you very much.
Thank you, Madhulika. Thank you, Madhulika Rai. So I shall play the recorded video. Okay, so just give me a minute. Yeah, so Madhulika, can you please switch off your video? Thank you.
Good afternoon. The March for Science Abroad has requested me to talk about a very important subject, science in ancient India. It has become important because various ideas, often unfounded ideas, based on personal beliefs, have been propagated over the last few years in the name of rewriting Indian history. And the problem is confounded because of the fact that throughout our educational career, especially in school, we have studied history, but history has been conveyed to us just as a narration of events that happened. And we were never told, how did we come to know about this, that this really happened? We were never told that history demands evidence. And since we were never told that, when somebody says that such and such things are Indian history, another person says that, no, 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 not that, something else in Indian history, people often think that it is history for you, it is history for him, it is history for somebody else. So different people may believe in different courses of history. No. Only one thing actually happened. And it is our task to find out what actually happened. This is one problem. The second problem is that because of the spread of a kind of nationalism, there have been some people who tend to believe that all that has come from Europe, especially the modern science and technology, all these were there in the Vedic time. There is nothing new that is being brought by the European civilization. And in contrast, there are also people who think that there was nothing in the Indian civilization. Everything that is modern has come from Europe and the Americas. Both these ideas are wrong. We need to understand what actually happened and how do we really know that happened on the basis of what evidence. This is what I'll be talking about. So let us go to the slides now. So science in ancient India, reality versus myth. Now, when we discuss this, we have to subdivide the history of India into a few epochs. And these time periods normally are the Indus Valley Civilization, which spread from 3500 BC to about 1800 BC. The Vedic Age, which started from about 1500 BC and it went up to about 600 BC. You might ask, what is the evidence? For Indus Valley Civilization, the evidences are natural because we have found things in those archaeological sites, and these can be radiometrically dated. We did not find any evidence of a civilization after 1800 BC, so we can assume that ended around that time. And the Vedic age started around 1500 BC. What is the evidence of that? I'll come to that later. It ended around 600 BC because the Buddhist and the Jainist religion started around that time. And within 100 years of Buddha's lifetime, almost the subcontinent became Buddhist. So we consider that as the end of the Vedic age. And then started the post-Vedic period, which spread from about 600 BC to about 1100 AD. And that is when we see a decline of science in India. And then we have the medieval period from the 12th century to about 19th century. And then we have the modern age, where we again find resurgence of science in India. So let us start with the Indus Valley Civilization. It is a large area that was covered by about 10 lakh square kilometer area in this part of the world. And here we find a large number, very large number, more than 100 individual cities spread over a large geographical area. And the timing is, as I said, around 3500 BC to about 1800 BC. And these places almost have a similar kind of architectural tradition, where we find a citadel, a raised area, where normally there would be a granary, which is in a raised platform so that it doesn't get inundated during floods. Though this particular structure is a later structure. This particular structure is not of that time. It was a later structure. But it was built on that platform, which I'm talking about. In the foreground, you can see this great bath. And the most remarkable part of the Harappan civilization are the drainage systems. There are private houses. Almost everyone has his own well, a bathing space, a toilet and the drainage system that takes out the dirty water through covered drains. These were actually covered drains. And we find walls like this. So these are relatively advanced architectural tradition of that time in comparison to the other cultures of that time. And most important factor is that these are made of bricks. The structures are made of bricks, and the bricks have a uniform ratio all over the Harappan cities. 1:2:4. The regularity of the plan and construction that suggests a kind of organization and a bureaucratic centralism. And but still we find no monumental architecture, which means there is no big palaces, no big temples. And this indicates that class division was in a relatively rudimentary stage at that time. In this time, we find some rudiments of mathematics coming into picture. You just imagine you having to design and do something like this. Obviously, you immediately face the problem of drawing a rectangle. And a rectangle drawing essentially entails drawing perpendiculars. So obviously, they had the means of figuring this out. So in that sense, there was development in geometry. And we find weights and measures that also indicate some development of geometry. And we find this kind of geometrical patterns in their seals. And these also talk about some idea of geometry. So we find some development in geometry in the Indus Valley civilization, but at certain point of time, there was decline and extinction of this particular civilization. We don't really know the reason for that to happen, but there are various possible reasons that people have tried to figure out. For example, the climate change, a long drought or flood, the possibility of a agricultural reduction in agricultural production due to some reason, and such kind of city states essentially survive on the basis of agricultural production elsewhere outside the cities. And if that declines, the cities also cannot survive. And also the possibility of plague and other contagious diseases. But we know that at certain point, the cities were abundant, and that is when the civilization effectively ended. And then we, after some time, we see the onset of the Vedic Age. It is now more or less agreed, though this is disputed by some people, but it is more or less agreed by the scientific community that there was, at some point of time, a migration of Aryan-speaking tribes from the Asia Minor into various regions, and some of these tribes entered the Indian subcontinent. And these were horse riding, pastoral, migratory tribes. And they didn't know agriculture, but their main source of livelihood was animal husbandry. And they did not have a written language. That is why you have the Shruti and Smriti in the Vedic tradition. More or less, we can piece together the migration routes. And here is one migration route that entered the Indian subcontinent. But how do you know about that? And how do we piece together the timing? Essentially, unlike the earlier Indus Valley civilization, we do not find any physical remains of the Vedic civilization. The basic reason is that they did not make houses out of bricks. So the literature they created, the Vedas, the Vedanga, Vedanta, Puranas, Upanishads, Brahman, Samhita, a rich collection of literature, and we piece together their culture as well as their timing from these literature that we have. So these provide the evidence of various things. We know that they wrote numbers, and they wrote numbers in a 10-base system. This 10-base system is not followed everywhere. For example, in Mesopotamia, in Babylon, they used a 60-base system. In other countries, there were different kinds of systems that were in use. but here they use a 10 base system. But there is a difference from the decimal system that we use today. They didn't know the number zero. And so there were 9 basic number symbols. And when they went to 10, they needed a special symbol for that. And they could make 11, 12, 13, 14 by putting the 10 symbol and the 1 symbol, 2 symbol next to each other. And then as you reach 20, they need a new symbol. So that was the way they wrote. And even much later, in the Kharoshthi writings at the time of Ashoka, we still find this kind of writing system where there are special symbols for 10, 30, 20, 30, 100, 1000, and so on and so forth. In the Vedic times, we even though they could not write such big numbers because they needed special characters for them, but still we find that they conceived large numbers up to a trillion. We find that in Krishna Yajurveda. They could figure out the odd numbers, multiples of 4. They also had the idea of fractions. For example, we see when 3/4 of Purusha went up, 1/4 of him remained. So 3/4 and 1/4 make 1. That understanding was there. And we see some rudimentary concepts of geometry in various literature. But we find the relatively more advanced form of geometry in what are known as the Sulba Sutras. I'll come to that. The Sulba Sutras essentially were 7 Sulba Sutras. Sulba means the thread. Sulba Sutra means the rule of the thread. Essentially what they did was, these were written as sort of instruction manual. Instruction manual for what? To make the Yajna Vedi, the altars for performing the yajnas. Now that is a elevated structure of a particular geometrical shape, either a square or a rectangle or a circle or something. And therefore they had to figure out ways of doing that. And one of the starting points is to identify the east, west, north, south. And that's not a very easy problem. And they did solve it. For example, in order to find out the east-west line, their prescription was that put a pole, and then with the help of a thread, you draw a circle. When the sun rises, it will cast a shadow and mark the point at which it cuts the circle. When the sun sets, again, it will cast a shadow and mark the point where it will intersect the circle. And the line joining these two is the east-west line. And that is really true east-west line. How to draw a perpendicular bisector? Simple. Just put 2 points A and P and take a thread, stretch it and mark the midpoint, hold it there and stretch it to the other side. Again, mark the midpoint, hold it there. And then just join these two lines, that will be the perpendicular bisector. It's interesting to note that what we know as the Pythagoras theorem, that was there in some form in the Bodhayan Sulva Sutra. The statement effectively says that a rope stretched around the length of a diagonal produces an area which the vertical and horizontal sides make together. Effectively, that is the statement of the Sulva Sutras. So the question of the statement of the Pythagoras theorem. Now, the question naturally arises, who invented the Pythagoras theorem? Now, historians have found that the Egyptian pyramids, those who made the pyramids, definitely did have some idea of the Pythagoras theorem in order to construct the geometry of them. And the idea of Pythagorean triplets, like 3 square plus 4 square is equal to 5 square. 5 square plus 12 square is equal to 13 square. These are the Pythagorean triplets. That idea was there in Mesopotamia. And the first statement of the Pythagoras theorem was in the Sulva Sutras. And the first proof came from China. And all these are before Pythagoras. So obviously Pythagoras did not invent the Pythagoras theorem. He basically put it down in a proper mathematical form. And that's how other people know these as the Pythagoras theorem. In the Sulba Sutras, we find certain ways of calculating square root of 2. It is easy to find, easy to understand why they needed to find the square root of 2, because a square of side 1 will have the diagonal of the size square root of 2. They wanted to figure that out, and we find this kind of expressions which effectively lead to the square root of 2 as 1.4 from this, square root of 2 is 1.4166 from this kind of expression. So effectively they're trying to reach more and more accurate expression. But capping it all is this expression that we found in the Bodhayan Sulba Sutra. Now historians argue that this was arrived at through a geometrical means, but it's a series that they have found out, and it's quite accurate up to the fifth decimal place. That's remarkable. One of the things that the Sulba Sutras tried to do was, well, at the time, basically the altars were meant for yagnas, and yagnas were meant for different gods. And you know, in this system, different gods sometimes had the same hierarchical position. So if two gods have different hierarchical position, and one has to make two different shapes for them, but of the same area, then effectively, mathematically, that leads to a problem where one has to make a circle of the same area as a given square. So the way they try to construct it is something like this. Suppose ABCD is a starting square. You draw this line, and then you draw this circle. And this is the line that goes through. And M is the point at which it intersects. And this line is intersected at point N by this ABCD. So there are, divide this line MN into two parts, 2/3 and 1/3. And then you identify the point P, which is 2/3 from N and 1/3 from N. And then the circle you draw is the circle that you want. If you do that today, you will find that that's not exactly the equal area of that ABCD square, slightly off, but not reasonably accurate. In astronomy, for example, in the Vedic period, we had to formulate a calendar because agriculture started. They did not come with agriculture, but around 1000 BC, we find agriculture starting. And wherever there is agriculture, they had to formulate a calendar. So did the Vedic people. And we find something called Vedanga Yotisha. So there are six Vedangas. Out of that, one is the Vedanga Yotisha. Remember, Yotisha, this word, does not mean what it means today. It does not mean astrology. In those times, it was used to mean astronomy. Astrology was a later construct. And in this Vedic astronomy, we find that they counted months on the basis of the phases of the moon, and year on the basis of the motion of the sun. And so there were obviously some difficulties because the lunar rotational time is not, or the year, which is the motion of the earth around the sun, that is not an integral multiple of the motion of the moon. And therefore, there are difficulties formulation of a calendar. And still, they were found that they managed to construct 12 solar months and 6 ritus. And they could find there are two phases in the year, the Uttarayan and Dakshinayan. And then they could identify the summer and winter solstices, Sankranti. And they also named 27 stars along the path of the sun and the moon. That's the zodiacal strip. On that, they managed to identify 25 stars and name them. We still call these by those Sanskrit names. These are advancements. In medical science, for example, in Atharva Veda, we find various empirical observations were slowly being systematized into the anatomy, physiology, and medicine And then at a later stage, Ayurveda, Ayurveda was written in the late Vedic period and early Siddhantic period, post-Vedic period. And Ayurveda was an extension of that tradition. Essentially, in Atharvaveda, we find two types of prescription in dealing with diseases. One uses magic, various kinds of occult practices, and the other tries to deal with it using substances like medicinal plants, like salts, like various physical substances. And the, Ayurveda essentially developed out of the second tradition, where various diseases they wanted to, they tried to cure using various medicinal plants they could identify using empirical techniques. But many people believe that the ancient India was a time of spirituality, which is not actually true. What we find is that in the Rig Veda, the gods and the way the chants and hymns were written, essentially these are praise of the gods and asking for material benefits in return. And the gods were essentially embodiment or deification of some Aryan leader or some natural force. Okay, sun, wind, or Indra was a Aryan leader who was successful in defeating the non-Aryans. And this is how the gods were there. So these are not any, these are very material gods. And in those times, various materialistic practices were there. And that is why the anthropologists essentially classify the Rig Vedic time as the magic phase, where they tried to please the natural forces, not any supernatural god, the natural forces, by various practices. So it is a common misconception that the spiritualism is the characteristic feature of the Vedic times. It is not true, because in those times, various schools of philosophy developed, like Lokayata, like Nyaya, Vaisheshika, Samkhya, and most of these were actually materialistic traditions. So this is important to note. For example, the Lokayata tradition identified as the basic constituents of everything as the Chaturbhuta, the earth, water, air, and fire. At a later time, in Samkhya, for example, another was added, that is the sky. So Panchabhuta, they said. Effectively, these are material entities. And so they conceived everything to be composed of material entities. So in that sense, it was a materialistic philosophy that was dominant at that time. We see that various claims have been made. For example, that there is a claim that there was no non-Aryan, there was no Aryan migration into India. Let's analyze whether this can be so. There's another claim that Aryans are indigenous people of India. They didn't come from outside. And there is also a claim that the Vedic culture was 10,000 years old. Somebody says 50,000 years old. Somebody says 1 lakh years old. Different people claim different things. So let's analyze. And there is a claim that all the science and technology that modern era has seen were also known in the Vedic times. And the Indus Valley civilization was a part of the Vedic age. Now, is it true? Look at the evidences. The structure of the Indus Valley civilization were made of bricks, but not a single brick has been found from the 1,000 year span of the Vedic era. The first brick was found something like 5th century, 6th century AD, which means after a long time. The first, the buildings that we find, for example, the Sanchi Stupa of Ashoka's time, that is made of wood and timber, stone and timber, no brick. This is the first brick building that is found, that is in a place called Bhitargaon in Kanpur district of UP. So the point is that the the Harappan civilization people made bricks, but after that, a long time was there when there was no brick used. So that essentially means there was no cultural exchange between the two civilizations. We find a lot of seals in the Indus Valley, seals like this, and you notice that each contains a picture of an animal, and there's no horse. There's no horse. Even imaginary animal, like the unicorn was there, which has a body like a bull, but it has one horn. But this is imaginary animal, but there is no horse in any Indus Valley relic. But horse is a very dominant animal in the Vedic literature. So obviously, these two cultures are different. The Indus Valley people had written script like this. We have not been able to decipher them, but we know that they did have this kind of script, and linguists have commented, have found that this was written from the right to the left. But we know that the early Vedic people did not have written script, and that's why they used Shruti and Smriti in order to perpetuate their oral tradition of the Rig Vedas. Later, after 1000 AD, this came to be written up when Lipi developed, the written script developed. There is no mention of any city life, of big buildings, the grid pattern of the streets, drainage system, etc., in any of the Vedic literature. The Vedas, Vedanga, Vedanta, Samhita, nowhere. And so all these put together gives us the idea that the two civilizations, the Indus Valley civilization and the Vedic culture, they were culturally separated. There was no mixing between them. And there is also a claim that the Vedic Aryans were indigenous people of India. Let's analyze that. Most important evidence is a horse. Horse is not an Indian animal. But we do find horse in India today. Obviously, they must have been brought. They do not of themselves come from one place to another. They were people came with horses. And the first evidence of horse we find in the Swat culture in Pakistan, and that is around 1600 BC. Which means around that time, people were coming into India with horses. And after that time, we find literature full of horses. Linguistics, another most important evidence. The languages spoken in India and in Europe have, we know linguists are certain about it, that they have a common root. Because there are certain similarities, commonalities between these languages, which cannot happen unless they come from a common root. For example, there are words similar to each other. In English, we say brother. In Greek, they say frater. In Latin, again, frater. And Sanskrit, we say bhrata. In English, father. In Greek, pater. So we say paternal uncle. Latin, also pater. And then in Sanskrit, it's pita. And so on and so forth. There are similarity in words. But even more important are the similarity in the grammar. For example, we have case, karaka. And in various languages, we see similarity in the use of the case. The gender, the three genders, masculine, feminine, and neuter gender. These are there in many of the Indo-European languages, many Indian languages, as well as many European languages. The number, singular, dual, plural. In Sanskrit, for example, we say, Gachami, Gachaba, Gachama. That means singular, Gachami. Two of them, Gachaba. Many of them, Gachama. So these are, that means the verb changes depending on whether it's singular, dual, or plural. That is also similar in many other languages in Europe. In many Indian languages, the verb changes depending on what a person is doing. The verb changes depending on the masculinity and femininity. And that is also common among various Indo-European languages. And that's why it's believed that this language group has radiated with human migrations, and there was a common birthplace, and that is believed to be somewhere in the Asia Minor. And the way languages develop, the way, for example, organisms develop, depending on that, since organisms develop in a particular way, if a particular fossil is found by a, then a trained biologist can immediately say that this fossil cannot be after this time. So similarly, if a particular word or phrase or expression is found in language, a linguist can say this cannot have formed before this time. Similarly, this way also we can find some kind of timing of the Vedic age. And the linguists have now formulated some kind of a language tree, and where the Proto-Indo-European language family actually led to two major classes of languages. One class is called the Centum languages, and the class is called the Setim languages. And the Centum languages is the mother of all the modern, in the last line you see all the modern languages. These are the mother of all the modern European languages. And the Setim language family is the mother of most of the modern Indian and Middle Eastern languages. And they have all some common root. That's why the historians believe that a few waves of migration of Aryan-speaking people occurred around in the period from 2000 BC to about 1500 BC. But importantly, there's no evidence of warfare or destruction in the Indus Valley cities. So it is assumed that the cities died off on their own due to some natural causes, and the Vedic people, the pastoral tribes for the Asia Minor, they entered somewhat later. One thing we have to note, that Aryan myth, Aryan is not a race, it is a language group. And those who spoke that group of languages were called Aryans. And the Aryan myth was actually created, that it's a race, it's a superior race and things like that. This was created by the German fascists. And we have to steer clear of that. So let's go to the post-Vedic or Siddhantic period. This is the time when we really see great development of science in India. For example, medical science. We see eminent figures like Sushruta, Atreya, Jivaka, Charaka. So these people are eminent physicians of that time. We have written records of Sushruta and Charaka. Sushruta mentioned the name of the king of his time, so we can place his timing, which Charaka did not do. So the Charaka Samhita's timing is somewhat uncertain. But most important feature of the development of medical science of that time is the development of surgery. And surgical techniques were developed by mainly Sushruta. His Samhita, we find this kind of surgical instruments. In fact, more than 100 different types of surgical instruments were mentioned in the Sushruta Samhita. In linguistics, we see the great linguist Panini, 4th century BC, the first grammarian of antiquity. And he gave the rules of Sanskrit grammar. Before that, it was a spoken form of Sanskrit. Before that, it was Sanskrit in the sense that it was refined from the spoken languages, but the rules were not formalized. And as a result of which, the rules varied from place to place. But after Panini, it becomes standardized, and that became sort of a linked language over the whole of the Indian subcontinent. And he arranged the alphabets in a scientific way, the way these are pronounced, the way the tongue touches various parts of the mouth, and the amount of sound that comes, the amount of air that comes out of the mouth. According to that, this kind of a matrix was formed, and this is different parts of the mouth. So this way, a scientific way of arranging the alphabets. This is not found in any other language except the Indian languages. In astronomy, we find the Siddhanta Jyotisha books. Actually, many books are there. If you read the names of the books here, you will find names like the Romak Siddhanta, Polish Siddhanta, Yavan Siddhanta. Obviously, these were mentions of foreign influence. And that's obvious, that's natural, because before that time, the Alexander invasion happened. And through that, various contacts were established. And therefore, the astronomy that was in vogue in the Greek cities, even the Greek cities that were outside Greece, Alexandria, for example, that astronomy came to India. And that's when we find the mixture of the Indian tradition, Indian knowledge, as well as the European knowledge, taking shape in the Siddhanta Jyotisha books. In the Siddhanta Jyotisha, we find the time length of the year was very accurately estimated, something like this, but they did not have a way of writing it like this. So effectively, they tried to figure out when does exactly sun rise exactly the same point. They noticed that after a year completes, 365 days complete, the sun is not exactly at the same point at sunrise, slightly off, and that they measured. And from there, they could figure out that exactly the same position will come so many years later. That was called a Mahayuga. It is not very, what should I say? It is strange, of course. It is remarkable, of course. But it's very, you know, result of very material observation of those people. Meticulous observation of this people. In this time, we find emergence of Aryabhatta, 5th century AD. He was the first to hypothesize that the earth itself rotates. We see the sun going from one side to the other, the moon going from one side to the other. In the night, you notice the sky itself going from the east to the west. But he said that no, it's not that these things are going from the east to the west. It is basically the earth that is rotating. This idea was not accepted during his time, even 200, 300 years after his death. People after him contradicted him. They even said, great scholars like Brahmagupta and Varahamihira, they say that Aryabhatta has sort of corrupted astronomy. So they didn't accept his idea. But it is also true that his ideas were advanced, but it's also true that he did not reach the Copernican model. His ideas were similar to the Ptolemaic model. As I said, that by then the Greek astronomical ideas had reached India, and Ptolemy's idea was basically that the planets moves in circles over circles. These are epicycles, and in Aryabhatta we see a similar kind of theorization. And he gave explanation of the solar and lunar eclipses, more or less that explanation. In mathematics, we find a great leap forward in the Siddhantic period, first with the Jain mathematicians, whose major contribution was to free Indian mathematics from the religious and ritualistic constraints. That I said was the main motivation behind the Sulba Sutras, basically religious and ritualistic practices. They sort of made mathematics stand on its own feet. And they talked about numbers, large numbers, even infinity. They constructed, for example, what we today know as the Pascal triangle, the binomial coefficients, Fibonacci numbers. So these are works of pure mathematics. So the Jain mathematicians made mathematics stand on its own feet. Now the most important development, the development of zero. Now that the absence of something is also a number, it is not easy to conceive. Today even a child knows that, but in those times it was not easy to conceive that the absence of something is also a number. We have 8 bananas, 3 apples, 5 deer, but there is no deer is also a number. It's difficult to conceive, and that was conceived in the Indian subcontinent. Well, I would say that we do not know exactly where, because the in those times there were trade between the Indian subcontinent, the Southeast Asia, China, and it may have originated in any of these places, but the use of zero, before the use of zero, these 20, 30, 40 required separate symbols. And when the use of zero was invented, soon after we see the advent of the place value system, the way we write numbers. Like the 3905 number is written as 3 × 10³, 9 × 10³, depending on the position, these have different weights. And this place value system was developed in the Indian subcontinent. As I was saying, it is not clear exactly where, because the first evidence of zero, written evidence of zero, is found in Cambodia, Kampuchea, not in Indian subcontinent, not in India actually. So we do not know exactly where it originated, but we do know that its large scale use started in India. So it appears now that the concept of zero appears sometime in the 2nd or 3rd century AD, and large scale use started in around 6th century AD. Einstein says, we owe a lot to Indians who taught us how to count, without which no worthwhile scientific discovery could have been made. Some evidences, this Bakshali manuscript was discovered some in a place called Bakshali in today's Pakistan, and it is now there in the Oxford Museum. And this gives an example of the kind of mathematics they were doing around that time, 400 AD. It includes algebra, arithmetic, mensuration, and things like that. The Indian, the timescale of mathematics, Sulba Sutras, 800 BC to 200 BC, many Sulba Sutras written in this time. Pingala, the Jain mathematician, and 200 BC. Other Jain mathematicians from 400 BC to 200 AD. Bakshali manuscript was around 4th century AD. Then names, great names, Aryabhatta, 5th century, Varahamihira, 6th century, Brahmagupta, 7th century, Mahavira, 9th century. And then we see this sort of a decline in science, and the last, you know, flame of science was through Bhaskaracharya, 12th century AD. And after that, for the, over the most of the Indian subcontinent, science went into a decline. Only a light was burning in Kerala, that was 14th to 16th century AD, where a lot of good mathematics was done. And then we find again a gap, and finally we find Srinivas Ramanujan in the 19th century. Let's briefly talk about their contributions. Aryabhatta, for example, gave a value of pi up to 4 decimal places. He was the first to prepare a trigonometric table. He was not the first to prepare a trigonometric table as such. Table with 1 degree accuracy. So sine 1 degree, sine 2 degree, sine 3 degrees, that way he made the table. While the Greek mathematicians, Greek astronomers, Aristarchus and Hipparchus, they made tables, the first sine tables, in a more, you know, rudimentary and more coarse-grained fashion. Well, one thing I have to say, that in this period, in the Siddhantic period, due to some reason not very clear to me, one obsession of most mathematicians was to solve indeterminate equations. Equations where there are 2 unknowns and 1 equation, like this. Ax plus by is equal to c. A, b, c are whole numbers, and they were trying to find out, they showed that if x and y are whole numbers, then solutions exist. And they could find solutions of this kind of equations for specific values of a, b, and c. And the method was called Kuttaka method, and invented by Aryabhatta. And in Aryabhatta, his book, we find expressions like this, extremely interesting, written in prose form or poetry form, but effectively when written in mathematics, it's effectively this. Brahmaputra, for example, did a lot of work on cyclic quadrilaterals, and he further developed the solution method of solution of indeterminate equation, but not of the first order, of the second order, like this. These are called Diophantine equations. He developed a method called the Bhavana method of solving equations like this for integer values of x and y. Mahavira said that the square root of a negative number does not exist. And he also gave the first idea of combinations that we know, NCR. In Bhaskara, we have the grand glory of mathematics. He wrote books like Lilavati and Bijganitam, which were studied for about 500-600 years by people all over the country. Bijganitam was a treatise on algebra. Lilavati was actually a collection of puzzles from various areas. And in astronomy, he wrote Grahaganitam, computational method of predicting the position of planets, Siddhanta Siramani. Goladhyay is a book on spherical astronomy. Interesting. He developed spherical astronomy quite a lot. And he also wrote a book on observational astronomy, observational instruments. And there was a relatively easy to use tables. So Bhaskara had a lot of contribution in astronomy as well as mathematics. And in solution of indeterminate equation, as I already mentioned, the Kuttaka method by Aryabhata was for linear equations like this. Bhavana method by Brahmagupta was for nonlinear equations like this. And Bhaskaracharya developed a Chakravala method, this is an algorithmic technique, by which an equation like this can be solved. And interestingly, he gives solutions for n is equal to 61, n is equal to 67. For example, if n is equal to 61, it is like this. And the smallest solution in positive integers are such horribly large solutions where he could find them. But if you change n to 60, it becomes so small. So finding solutions were not easy, but he found an algorithmic method by which he could do that. And again, these problems were posed much later by Fermat, who posed this problem to European mathematicians to solve this equation. Little did he know that this equation has been solved many centuries back by Bhaskara. Bhaskara was actually the last flash of light before science was extinguished in much of the Indian subcontinent. And then we find the Kerala mathematicians, Madhava, Jeshtadeva, Nilakantha Soumyaji, and their contribution is in terms of the infinite series, power series, whether the series converges or not in trigonometry. And we see the rudimentary birth of calculus, the ideas of calculus being born. The question now is, why did science decline and fall? Well, if you notice the timings, you'll find there was a golden age of science in India. For example, discovery of zero and the position weight system around this time. And obviously, if you change from one number system to another number system, you have to change the whole arithmetical procedures. Everything was developed in India. Great development. The advances of medicine and surgery by Charaka, Sushruta, great developments. Then we have Aryabhata, Varahamihira, Brahmagupta, Sridhara, Bhaskara. Brahmagupta's book, Brahmasputa Siddhanta, was translated into Arabic, and that introduced Arabs to the Indian way of doing mathematics. And this book was sort of a textbook for the Arab scholars for about, say, 400 to 500 years, or Sindh Hind, they used to call it. So great developments happened. But after that, we find a gap. And then we again find the Indian Renaissance happening, and then a large number of scientists emerging in the 19th century. What happened in between? Now, this question was explored by Acharya P.C. Ray, who wrote a book called History of Hindu Chemistry. In that book, there is a chapter devoted to this particular issue. He identified three causative factors. The first was that introduction of casteism in a rigid form. His point was that in order to do science, the doer and the thinker had to be either the same people or had to be in collaboration with each other. But with the development of casteism, the person who did not think, were not allowed to think, and those who thought did not do anything. So the separation of between the doer and the thinker killed off science in India. And at some point of time, the do's and don'ts, do this, don't do that, and all this kind of strictures came in the Shastras. In fact, he identified the Manu Samhita as the book responsible for introduction of these. And they sort of prohibited the use of or touching the cadaver, touching the dead bodies. And Acharya P.C. Ray mentions that in order for a doctor, a physician, a surgeon, to convey his ideas to the next generation of pupils, they have to dissect human bodies. He has to show where which organ is there. And beyond a certain time, this became impossible because of the religious strictures, and the whole tradition died off. The third important factor he identified is that the spread and intellectual dominance of the Vedanta philosophy, mainly through Shankara, which said that the material world is illusion, Maya, and asked people to look away from the material world to something beyond the material world. And if people do not have questions about the material world, then they obviously do not do any science. And this also was a factor responsible for the death of science in India. Notice that the death or the decline started around 9th century, and the last speck of light we find not in the main part of India. Bhaskaracharya was from today's Karnataka, so the center of learning moved down south, and after Bhaskara that also extinguished, it moved even further down south to Kerala. The rest of India was actually in the grip of a dark age. Remember, this happened before the intrusion of the Muslim invaders. This decline and fall happened before that. It was not because of the Muslim invasion. And then we find a long period of stagnation without any development in science, except a few small areas like metallurgy, because the rulers needed development of weapons, so metallurgy developed a bit. But otherwise, it was basically a period of stagnation. And finally, we find in the 19th century, again, emergence of science in India. It was not directly starting of science per se. The Indian Renaissance started with Raja Ramamohan Ray and Ishwarchandra Vidyasagar, who brought the ideas of European Enlightenment and Renaissance into India, and they spread those ideas into the Indian populace, and that had an immediate result. Vidyasagar, look at the timing. He was at his peak in the 1860s, 1870s, and it was during this time that most of the people who shine later were educated. And in the next generation, we found that a galaxy of scientists emerging. J.C. Bose, Prafulla Chandra Ray, C.V. Raman, Meghnad Saha, Satyendranath Bose, Ramanujan, Mahalanobis, and so on and so forth. A galaxy of scientists emerged in India. The ground was ready, but the culture for a long time was a bigotry and religious superstitions. That's why this could not flourish. The moment the light of European Renaissance came into India, they could flourish. I would stop here. Thank you.
Good afternoon.
Yes, I can now take questions.
Hi. Can you hear me?
Yes, I can.
Yeah, thank you, Professor.
There's a lot of echo.
Can you hear me now?
There's a lot of echo.
So, just wait for me. The thing is that.
Abhishek, just wait for me. So I will replace.
If you can hear me, I request everybody to mute their microphones so that one can speak.
So, hello, I have a question. Shall I ask?
Give me a moment. So, essentially, I will request everyone to switch on their videos, but keep your microphone in the mute mode. So whenever you ask question, you unmute it, and then once your question is over, you just again go to the mute mode. And please come one by one, and you can also raise your hand in that case, and also in the chat box, I shall try to coordinate. Also, there are some questions may come from the YouTube live. So we have our moderator, Dr. Venkateshan, who will also enter at some moment with these questions. So we go with Tanmay. So once again, another thing, when you pose your question, please tell your name and the place where are you now and before you start your question. Yes, please go ahead, Tanmay.
Okay, myself Tanmay. So I'm a PhD student in the Hebrew University of Jerusalem. So my question is that NASA showed the Ram Setu, okay? So is it not the proof of the ancient technology?
Professor Banerjee, you have to unmute yourself.
Yeah. If you actually visit the place, Rameswaram, you will find that place, it is true that from the satellite image, a shoal-like structure, a connecting structure is seen. But if you look at it carefully, you will find that is mainly silt deposition. And therefore, there must be some physical process of the silt deposition. Now, another factor, if you go there, you will find that the stones that are found there, these are not really stones. These are actually dead coral. So it is now, therefore, easily you can guess that this was a place where there was shallow sea and there was a coral reef there which died for some time, and that made the rocks. Now, why does two pieces of land get connected by a bridge-like structure? If it were only in one place, then you would say something is really fishy. But such structures have been found in different places all over the world. For example, one side of Alaska and the other side of Siberia are connected by a very narrow strait, and in some time in the past, they were connected. So there are places where things come very close, land masses come very close, and there are connections that develop. Why? Because in that part, the waves, the flow of water in the sea that gets impeded, so becomes slow, and therefore whatever is contained, silt material contained in the water, that gets deposited there. It's a natural process that happens. It is interesting to note that the people who wrote, it is not a person who wrote, the people who wrote the Ramayana, it was written for over a period of about 600 years, they noticed this particular fact and integrated that into the storyline. It's very interesting. Yeah, let's continue.
Okay. So, okay, we'll go for the next question. Maybe Abhishek, you go now with your question.
Yeah, so Professor Banerjee, so although-
Your name and place first?
Yes.
Yeah. So, hi, this is Abhishek. I'm doing postdoc at Texas A&M University,
yeah.
Poly Station, USA. So although it's not my belief, normally we have to face often a normal equation like that. Isn't it true that Muslim invasion is a responsible, is a factor or main factor to decline in science in ancient India? Because you already mentioned a gap of that era. So
yes.
Can you explain?
If you notice, I said that the decline started around the 9th century, because after that, for some time, we don't find any science until Bhaskara. So the decline started, and the last light was Bhaskara, 12th century. So the onset of the decline, just notice that it is about 9th century in India. When did the Islamic invasion start? The Muhammad Ghazni actually did intrude into the western part. He came as far only about Peshawar, which is today's Pakistan. That was about 11th century. So 11th century, notice this. Then Muhammad Ghori, about 100 years later, he invaded, he defeated the Ghazni rulers and came to up to Rajasthan. He fought with the Rajput ruler at that time. And the boundary of the Islamic kingdom was extended up to Rajasthan. In the 12th century, one of the slaves of Ghori, his name was Qutubuddin Aibak, he became a king and established the Delhi Sultanate. That means it came up to Delhi in the 12th century. And the actual, intrusion of the Islamic culture into the Indian mainland happened after Babur, when the Mughals came. And that was 16th century. So you see, the decline happened at a time when there was practically no Islamic culture in the Indian soil. Let's go to the next question.
Just a minute.
I have a question.
I have already received several questions, so let me just proceed one by one. And I will first go. So, Merin, you posed some question. Maybe you can directly tell here, because we have the scope to have direct interaction. Merin, can you please switch on your video as well as unmute yourself?
Hi.
Mm-hmm. Yes.
So, I'm Merin. I'm from UK. I'm a PhD student in University of Leeds. Okay, so I have two questions. First question is, so in your talk, you mentioned about transfer of idea during the time of Ptolemy and Aryabhatta. So how was this scientific idea transfer? How do you think this idea transfer happened? Due to trade, I don't think people will be talking about scientific ideas or things like that. Like, how did that happen? And my second question is, in the Bhaskara script, is the numbers Indo-Arabic numerals used? Did they use that or the Indian scriptures? Because I have found that in various languages they have their own numerals. So I'm curious which kind of numerals did he use there?
Good. The first question, the transfusion of ideas between different cultures often either happen through invasions or through trade routes. For example, the Silk Route, that was essentially a trade route between China and various other parts, that was responsible for transfusion of various ideas. In a similar way, if there are trade routes, it's not that the traders are themselves philosophers. It's not like that. What happens is that often people go with that convoy from one place to another. Books go from one place to another, so they get read. So in the ancient time, that was the main mechanism of transfusion of ideas from one culture to another. And we see the mention of that in many of the Indian literature. For example, you see the the Siddhanta Jyotisha books have names that essentially mention their foreign origin. But the second one is more interesting question. You see, I said that the zero and place value system were started in India. Their way of calculating the arithmetic was started in India. And Brahmagupta's book was translated into Arabic, so it went there. But that was a time when it is said to be the golden age of Arabic science. They were looking for ideas. They were bringing people from everywhere into their main city, Baghdad. And they had a huge building dedicated to translating those books. An army of people were working on translation. And you'd be surprised to note that there is only one city in the whole world whose founding was done through a scientific conference. That was the city of Baghdad. It was founded through a scientific conference, and the subject was observational astronomy. So they were so very interested. Now, when these books were translated into Arabic, they came to know about the Indian numeral system. Before that, they didn't know. And within 100 years, they adopted it. Which means that is why later, when this numeral system went to Europe, they still call it the Arabic numerals. But these are actually the Indian numerals. The way they write may be different. The letters may be different. The script, the symbols may be different. But the way we write, it is basically something that originated in India and that's transfused over the whole world through the medium of Arab.
Yeah, thank you.
Mm-hmm. Okay. Next question. Yes. So Siva Agarwal, Siva, you posed a very big question, but I would request you to shorten them, and maybe instead of so many questions, you place one or two questions maximum. So can you please switch on your video and come live and pose the question? Siva.
Hello, can you all see me?
Yeah.
Okay, so actually I have two questions for Professor. There are actually two questions. One is about the caste system that we see today in Vedas. Some people, they support the caste system and discrimination in society, that they believe that the task were assigned to people and it had nothing to do with discrimination. So what are your thoughts on that? First of all, I mean, if you can answer this question.
Yeah, but this is not exactly related to the subject matter of discussion today in a roundabout way it is, because I said that it is a caste system that at some point in time was responsible for the decline of science. Okay. Because of the caste system, the doers and thinkers became separate. And science flourished only when there is a very lively interaction between the doer and the thinker, or even better, if they're the same people. That stopped because of the caste system. But sociologically, I can tell you that in Europe, we see the advent of the slavery system, where some people were subjugated, they had to do what they're asked to do, and they had to do that. In India, we do not see the advent of slavery exactly in the same form, but it was replaced by a different thing, which amounted to be the same thing, slavery. So that was the caste system. So in India, the caste system played effectively the role of a slave-owning society, and that's how it developed. It is retrograde. It is something that blocked the advancement of science. And now also we have to do away with it in order for science to flourish.
If I can quickly ask another just second question.
Yeah, quickly.
So some people believe Ayurveda has all the cure for the disease. So what are your thoughts on that?
See, in my talk, I say that Ayurveda was developed in an empirical way. That means people had various experiences, tried out various things, and some worked, some did not work. Through that, a large amount of empirical experience accumulated. And that went into what is known as Ayurveda. But every school of thought has some kind of a theoretical structure. And for example, in Chinese medicine, the school of thought is something that the yin and yang, there are two things that are in together, they decide the health and things like that. In India, for example, the Ayurvedic idea was there are three things, Vayu, Pitta, and Kapha. And these three decide the physical well-being of everybody. We know now that is wrong. But that does not immediately mean that the empirical observations that they made are all wrong. Therefore, what is necessary today is to test those ideas on the basis of modern techniques of drug testing. And if we do...
Hello. I think there was a connection issue. Just give me a moment. So this is what we were afraid of, because during this COVID-19 time, all these network, they're not stable. More than that, on the weekends, there are this lockdown curfew, so you cannot go and get good internet access in your institutes and so. So essentially, this is the problem. So let me just...
Manodev, please request everyone to switch off the video mode, then may the network come.
Would it help? No, I actually wanted it because our session is actually live on YouTube, so people will get to hear. But see, during this time, we can ourselves also discuss a bit till the time Professor Banerjee is back. Okay, so essentially, what Shiva you mentioned, if I...
It seems I got disconnected. Yeah.
Yes. So yeah. Go ahead.
But where exactly I was disconnected, I'm not very sure. So...
The Ayurvedic medicine.
Yeah. So what needs to be done is to test the Ayurvedic medicines using the modern techniques of drug testing. And through that, we'll come to know exactly which molecules are responsible, which kind of action. And through that, new drugs can be found. What is actually happening is that people are only trusting their beliefs. And without going through the standard procedure, they are sort of going by mainly their beliefs. So that's what I would only want to say. Just take an example. When this COVID situation developed, even our Ayush ministry recommended the use of certain drugs coming from Ayurvedic sources, homeopathic sources, Yunani sources, and things like that. Any of these were tested in a rigorous manner? No. So belief should not be the basis. What should be the basis? Scientific testing. But I would not say everything that is there in Ayurveda are wrong. No, definitely not true. These need to be tested. Let's go to the next question.
Thank you, Professor.
Yes, Nimesh, you raise your hand, and also, so can you please switch on your unmute your.
Hi, my name is Giri. I'm from Royal Holloway University of London. So I have a question that so we have so in the talk there were so many claims of Aryan invasion. So here there was one claim that Aryans were the indigenous people of India. Similarly, there is another claim is there, like, you know, Dravidians are the indigenous people of India. So do you have any comment on that?
That will actually take us away from the main subject. I would request you to read the material that are now emerging through genetic analysis of the various populations that are there in India. Papers have been published over the last 10 years in Nature and other scientific journals, and that gives a clear idea about our genetic constitution. All I can tell you is that there's not much of difference between the Dravidian and me. Basically, we are the same people.
Yeah. Okay. Thank you.
Okay, so we'll go back to Nimesh. Nimesh, can you please switch on your video and unmute your audio.
Hi. Thank you, Professor. It was a wonderful talk. Am I audible?
Yeah.
Yes. Please introduce yourself quickly.
Yes. So I'm Nimesh. I'm doing my PhD in Institute of Bioengineering in Barcelona. And my question is regarding the development of scientific method as we know of today is based in European tradition in like ideas of induction, fact, and empiricism of Francis Bacon and Descartes and all these kind of European thinkers. Was there an Indian equivalent system or like a thinker who was developing a theoretical framework for science as such?
No, not really. The time at which this science was developed in India, at that time, the situation had not matured for the emergence of a Bacon or a Descartes. They emerged as a result of the Renaissance. Okay, and Renaissance was a particular socio-economic background in which the Renaissance happened. That background did not exist in India. Before the Renaissance, the kind of thinking that were there, many people, the Greek people also were great thinkers. There are Indian sages who were great thinkers. So thinking was there. But I would say that all that happened at the time was clash of ideas. And this clash of ideas were embodied in different kinds of philosophical traditions. And I said that there was the Lokayata philosophy. There was the Nyaya Vaisheshika philosophy. There was the Sankhya philosophy. But all these philosophical structures were of the I believe type. I believe this kind of things. Okay. And there were for example, the Lokayata people said they did not believe in Atma, the soul. They believed that everything needs evidence, proof. So without proof, I will not believe anything. That was what they say. These are very progressive and scientific, but by itself, science does not develop. Science has to develop in logical structure. That logical structure was really missing. So it is not only this or that, essentially wholesome philosophical background has to exist in order for modern science to develop. That actually did not develop. That's why much of the development actually happened in the direction of mathematics, where the actual physical sciences did not develop much in India. That's also true.
Okay, there are
with the Charavak tradition, there has been a strong tradition of skepticism in India, right?
What I said, Lokayata was essentially the Charavaka tradition. Yeah.
Okay, there have been several questions also coming from our YouTube viewers. So yes. Maybe I will request Dr. Venkateshan to switch on his video and also pose the questions on behalf of our viewers.
Okay, I am Venkateshan from Breakthrough Science Society. I was just monitoring the YouTube. Although in this Zoom, there are some audience like Chandrama, Maiti, and so all that who are raising hands. Maybe they may get a chance, I believe. But there are about 30 to 35 questions answered by some of the participants themselves. That is a good thing. Discussion was independently going on. But a few things which I picked up here. First, I will place certain trivial questions. A couple of them asked, Mandal and Sandeep Ghosh, they have asked the difference between mathematics during Vedic time and Vedic mathematics. What is the difference?
Yes. Various books with the title of Vedic mathematics have appeared. You'll find them in the market. And if you really open them, you will find these are basically some calculational techniques. And sometimes these are shortcuts. And all these things were originated by one priest in the Puri Math. And he claimed that he has read the Vedas and found these mathematics. And at that time, there were many scientists or historians also reading the Vedas and trying to figure out what mathematics was there. And they did not find those mathematics. So they asked him, where did we exactly find it? He said that I found it in a Parishishta, annexure. And they then started looking for it. Where is that annexure? And then again, they confronted him. Where did you find this annexure? He said that this is my annexure. So effectively, it means that all these that go in the name of Vedic mathematics were modern constructs by some people who gave it the name of Vedic mathematics. Now let's look at it. If you open those books, you will find that there is a use of the modern numeral system. I have already said that during the Vedic period, there was the modern numeral system was not there. There was no zero. There was no place value system. It was a different kind of writing numbers. Decimal, all right, but it's a different kind of writing numbers. In these Vedic mathematics books, you will find a modern way of writing the numbers. Obviously, this cannot be Vedic. That is why important mathematicians like Professor H.G. Dani, he was the president of the National Board of Higher Mathematics. He has contradicted these claims in several writings. Professor J.V. Narlikar, in his book, he writes that in many cases, modern things have been inserted into some ancient sloka. His word was prakshipta. This has been inserted into some ancient thing. Essentially, what they're trying to point out is that these are neither Vedic nor mathematics. Because in order for these to be mathematics, there has to be systematic procedure for it, systematic idea. While these are nothing but calculational techniques. And these also do not make calculation easy. Because there you'll find, if you read those books, you will find there is a specific way of squaring a number that ends with 5. But the same way, same method will not work for a number that ends with 6. So for each one, you will have to memorize a new formula that's useless as far as mathematics is concerned. That is why these books are neither mathematics nor Vedic. Mm-hmm. Next question.
This is also a clarification.
Yeah.
The Jyotisha during the ancient time and the astronomy, how do we see now?
Well, as I said, in the Vedic time, there was no astrology. There was astronomy, and astronomy was developing. I have already outlined exactly what developments were there. But astrology was something that came from outside. Now there is evidence that it came from outside. Astrology was practiced in Europe, in Greece. And through that, again, the trade route after Alexander's inflation, we see the first evidence of astrological literature in India. Before that, we see none. So there was no astrology in the Vedic tradition. It came later. And it was sort of integrated into the system because people tended to believe various things. But astrology and astronomy are entirely different things, and that came much later.
Okay.
So before we go to the next, can I take another question?
I have maximum 3 questions from them. Okay.
So I go for Chandima's question because in the chat box, I'm also following certain orders.
Yeah, I understand.
Chandima, can you please come forward?
Yeah. Thank you, sir, for your such an informative talk you delivered for us. And it is...
Can you
hear me?
Yeah, I can hear you. Could you start by introducing yourself?
Yeah, I am Chandima. I am doing PhD in Taiwan.
Okay.
So thank you, sir, for such an informative talk you delivered for us. And it is really a great pleasure for me to be here. So I have one question. In this discussion, you mentioned that, and we came to know that we have a very glorious history in Indian civilization. But nowadays, it is claimed that the modern achievement of science, like internet, television, or aircraft, and some different kinds of surgeries, like cosmetic surgeries or plastic surgeries, these were already developed in that time. But how can you make sure that it was not developed in that time?
Yes. This is a good question because you must have noticed that I did not mention any of these as the developments that happened in India. There are a few logical structures you have to understand. In order for a technology to develop, like the aircraft, you first have to develop a few theories. You have to develop theory of thermodynamics, you have to develop the theory of aerodynamics, you have to develop the theory of solid structures, and then only at some stage you can apply that to make an aircraft. If there is no evidence for the development of these theories, or these theories having been applied to other areas, then obviously there is reason for skepticism. A. Secondly, it has never happened so that somebody taking cue from some ancient text, some sloka, have got an idea about a modern development, say quantum mechanics, say aircraft, say cosmetic surgery, and actually did it. No modern invention has happened by taking cue from any of the ancient texts. And all those claims have always happened without exception after the modern development has happened. Nobody claimed that India had internet before the development of internet. Nobody claimed that India had aircraft before the development of aircraft. Nobody claimed that India had cosmetic surgery before the development of cosmetic surgery, so on and so forth. When the chief minister of Tripura said that India had internet because Sanjay was giving a running commentary and there was television, bhaiya kahin to milega. If there was television, then somewhere a relic of a television, the remains of a television, or if there were any aircraft, then some remains of an aircraft should be found in some archaeological site. Has anything been found? Never. So actually, we do not have any evidence of these developments having been happened at that time. There's no evidence. And history solidly depends on evidence. It does not depend on belief. And those who claim that these developments actually happened, they talk on the basis of belief without evidence. Okay.
So Harshit, you raise your hand. So maybe you pose your question with a quick self-introduction, but keep the question in context of the talk today.
Yeah. Thanks. Great to hear you again, sir. I'm Harshit. I'm currently at Microsoft from Amsterdam. My question is, I'm doing very good. Thanks, sir. So my question is, you said in the talk that Vedic people were mostly materialistic, and later on in the end of the talk you said that Indian science declined. One of the reasons was that there were more spiritualism that entered into Indian science. They were not doing materialistic things. Am I understanding this correctly? And going forward with this, was there no like evidence of spiritualism before, let's say, this ending of Indian or during the Vedic period also?
Yes. Well, what I said in the initial part of my talk refers to the Rig Vedic tradition. Mm-hmm. And Rig Vedic was the earliest Vedas. In that Rig Vedic tradition, the hymns, the way of worship, the way of doing things, these things were very, this carry the signature of what is known as the magic phase. Magic phase is where people try to please material forces, natural forces, the Vayu, the sun. These are the natural forces, and they try to please that so that their life becomes easy and they do not cause any harm. Mm-hmm. That was the early part. But to the later part of the Vedic period, yes, the spiritualism was developing. As I said, at that time, there were various schools of thought that were in existence. The Lokavayata was there, the Vedanta was there, two different opposite schools of thought. Nyaya Vaisheshika was there, Sankhya was there, and so on and so forth. All that schools, those schools of thought were in contradiction with each other. Some people believing this, some people believing that. And in that kind of a contradiction of ideas, science actually flourishes. Mm-hmm. So science did not find any difficulty in flourishing at that time. Only when there was a dominance of one kind of philosophy, which said that this material world is Maya. The material world is illusion. Look away from the material world into something else that's not material. When this philosophy became the dominant philosophy of the subcontinent, Acharya P.C. Ray says that is when the science went on a decline, because people did not look at the material things, ask questions about those things, and try to find answers to those questions. If they did that, science would develop. If they do not do that, science would not develop. So that was the argument, not my argument. It was taken from Acharya P.C. Ray. I had already cited his book, but I agree with his argument. So point is that all these traditions were there very much in India. From around 8th century, 9th century, the other traditions essentially died down. Did you notice at one point of time, the whole of the subcontinent from Afghanistan to Singapore was Buddhist? Mm-hmm. After the 9th century, there was no Buddhist practically. So something must have happened, right? So point is that when there is a dominance of one kind of philosophy, that is when the breeding ground of science essentially becomes sterile. That is what happened at one point of time.
Yeah, thanks.
Okay, now I will take questions coming from Aradhita. And partly this question is also echoed by Merin. So Aradhita, can you quickly pose your question?
Hi, I am Aradhita. I am doing my postdoc from Dublin. I basically have two questions. First question is, at what time, I mean, in the timeline that you had mentioned, did women education completely get destroyed, or like the scope was completely destroyed in the Aryan civilization? And the second question is, there is a saying from our ancestors that is like, crossing the sea is bad. So at what time this could have developed, and whether this could have to do something with the decline in science? Because if the trades are, if you say that the like if you cross the sea, that makes you a mlecha, then there is a problem in like getting into like to cross-mingling of cultures.
Yes.
So whether this has anything to do with the deterioration of the condition of science?
Yes. When I said that one of the reasons, one of the factors responsible for decline of science, as Acharya P.C. Ray has pointed out, is those strictures. You can do this, you cannot do this. And one of these I mentioned, that you cannot touch the cadaver. But there was another, that is, you cannot cross the seas. Okay. You cannot go to another land, alien land. So all these actually work towards the death of science in India. And well, there is no specific time when it happened. It happened slowly, but its effect became very pronounced after the 7th century. After the 7th century, the effect became very pronounced. The society becomes very cocooned. There was very little cross-cultural amalgamation. And so that is when the essentially Indian culture went into a stagnation, what I call as a dark age. Your first question regarding the women's education, well, it is generally true that only in the ancient, very ancient, before the start of agriculture and class division, women had equal position. But after this onset of agriculture and class division, women were subjugated everywhere. That happened in Greece, that happened in India, that happened in every place. And you will find that in the Indian tradition, women had a completely different kind of image, and that image was cultivated. Somebody who looks after the household, looks after the children, so they were not mean to be, you know, educated and learned, somebody who can be a teacher. That was never there in the Indian culture. But there were exceptions. In spite of this kind of cultural tradition, there were exceptional women who stood out and made their mark. So there have been such instances, but these were in spite of the system, not because of the system. Everywhere in the world, women were subjugated at that time.
Okay, so now I will go for Prakash to quickly pose his question. So please keep the question in the context of the talk.
Thank you, Van. Good afternoon, good evening, sir. Prakash here. I live in Eindhoven, Netherlands. I finished my formal education about 25 years ago, and I've been working with TCS for a long time now. Personally, I travel a lot, visit a lot of museums in understanding how things have evolved. So I wanted to understand your views on the background when you say the span of India. Where is it? Because when I see different Assyrian cultures, when I visited Museum of London or in Vatican, I saw similarities of Assyrian culture with Indian culture. We have people like Assurbanipal, and we have a reference of Asuras in our Vedic culture as well. But more than that, I am interested in inventions that have passed from these generations. We spoke of pure sciences, but practical inventions like navigation of sea, or gunpowder, which have evolved or made more civilizations powerful. Are there any evidences in India of those? That's what I'm interested in.
Well, the reference of Asuras in India and there being a king named Assurbanipal, there's no link between these two. Because the Assyrian king at the time, in the Mesopotamian culture, there were a few, dynasties, Akkadian dynasty, the Assyrian dynasty, the Babylonian dynasty. So these dynasties were there. One powerful king was Assurbanipal, who sort of ruled a large tract of land in that area. But there's no link between that. Asuras essentially was a name given by the Aryan speaking people to the non-Aryan speaking people. So that's how it developed. But regarding the use of technologies like gunpowder actually developed in China. In China, there were various, schools of thought. One was the Taoist schools of thought. And much of the alchemy developed from the Taoist schools of thought, alchemy. Basically, they were trying to make gold. And through that attempt, they often mixed various things. And in one literature, we'll find around, say, 9th century, 10th century, you'll find that, if you read Joseph Needham, he has a very nice treatise on that. You'll find reference that to never mix these two things, Sora and sulfur. Never mix these two things because something bad is going to happen. And then, obviously, if you write that, some people were going to do that. And therefore, people did that and found that it explodes. And around 11th century, that explosion was being used in making crude guns, bamboo with a bit of gunpowder put in it. And then that ignited. It shoots a projectile. So that started being used. So it is in China. And it transfused to other areas, again, through trade routes. It went to Europe in, say, 13th century. It came to India sometime later. Okay. So it came to India sometime later, but through trade routes. These were not invented in India or in Europe.
Mm-hmm. Okay.
The navigation part, shipping or navigation.
The navigation effectively has two components. A, how do you make the ship? And two, how do you navigate in the sea? Now, making the ship, essentially that this its foundation was given by Archimedes quite long back. And after that, people started making ships and making ships made of iron. Before that, they made ships of wood. And so that problem was sort of taken care of. The navigation also has a propulsive mechanism, and for a long time it was basically wind. But see, if there is wind, you go in the direction of the wind, but you might not want to go in the direction of the wind. So there has to be some kind of a sail that allows you to go in a different direction, even though the wind is flowing in one direction. And that again was invented by the Chinese. Okay. And that later went to the other parts. But the other problem, bigger problem is that if you're in the middle of the sea, how do you find out where you are? That means locating your latitude and longitude, that posed a major problem even for people like Columbus. Okay, how do you find out in the middle of the sea where you are? You will find that if you look at the literature, it's easier to find the latitude, but not the longitude. And therefore, in order to find the longitude, a lot of study was done even in Europe, even in London, there was a longitude institute. That means the whole institute was made in order to find the longitude. I'll not go into the details of it, but the problem was essentially sorted out around 16th century. And after that, people started going into the middle of the sea. Before that, they went always through the coastline. They went along the coastline. They had to traverse to larger distances in order to do that. But only from that time they started. But that development again happened in Europe. So effectively, the maritime transport developed through various inventions, some happening in China, some happening in Europe. And in this particular part, India did not make any contribution.
Okay, so I will take only one question from this Zoom webinar. But before I go to, and this is posed by actually Ipsita, before I go to that, I will request Dr. Venkateshan to place one or two more questions coming from our YouTube viewer. So Dr. Venkateshan, please.
Yes, there are a lot of questions, but I would pick up one question. Which has been asked by a few people, three, four people have been asking the same thing related to that horse evidence in Surkotoda site excavation. There are evidences of horse. Even the book by J.P. Joshi and Sharma, 1976 excavation, they say that there are evidences of horse relates to around 2000 BC. So how do we relate this? Because there are evidences coming out that horses were there.
Professor Banerjee.
Yeah, he's stuck. There are a lot of questions in the YouTube, but the YouTube viewers may excuse us. The organizers, it is very difficult to take up all the questions. So maybe the question answer session itself can be about an hour or more.
Yeah.
So kindly excuse and just picking up some relevant questions only now. I think Professor Somitro's net is frozen.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, he will join now. Will come now.
So till the time he joins, I would like to mention.
Somebody else can.
I would like to mention that on behalf of Breakthrough Science Society, there is a booklet exactly with the title of the talk today, title of the webinar today, The Science in Ancient India, Reality versus Myth. And it is actually much more rich in general than what you can say in a talk. So in case you people are interested, you can directly contact Breakthrough Science Society and maybe some soft version or maybe some hard.
I got disconnected, sorry.
So you got the question related
I
to
heard, horse. I heard the question, yes, the horse. The point is that, many people have claimed occurrence of horse before 1600 BC, but these have not been corroborated by professional archaeologists. For example, some 20 years back, a book appeared in which two people had claimed that they had a seal coming from the Harappan site, Harappa, and the seal shows the face of a horse. And later, a Harvard archaeologist contradicted that claim, saying that no, this is definitely not a horse seal. Basically, what these guys have done is to take a broken piece of seal and shine light from one side so that the shadow looks like the face of a horse, and that's the picture was taken. So this kind of, if people believe in things, they try to generate evidence, but as yet there is no evidence that has been, that has not been contradicted by archaeologists that say that there was evidence of horse in the Indian subcontinent before 600 BC.
Okay. Maybe I can just ask one more question from the YouTube readers. One is related to a question by Subhadeep Chakrabarty. He says that he finds some points similar to thermodynamics, like the concept of sannyas, which is similar to the concept of reaching maximum possible efficiency while reading Gita. So there are some questions like that. So. And there is also another question, similar.
It is not really related to Indian science, so let's leave those questions.
Gita, so he relates to Gita. So, okay, these are the questions.
Okay, so if no question from your side, maybe I will end with the question coming from Ipsita. Ipsita, can you please come forward, switch on your video, have a quick self-introduction, and then pose your question?
Yeah. Hi. Am I audible?
Yes, you are.
I'd really like to thank Professor Soumitra Banerjee first for such an informative talk. My question is somewhat related to I'm doing my PhD in Barcelona in the Institute of Photonic Science.
Yes, go ahead.
Yeah, my question is, so from your talk, we have learned that there was a significant contribution to the science and medical science from India in ancient times. But nowadays we can see that there are a lot of comments and agendas are going on, which is actually not science, but it's like pseudoscience. So is there anything we can do to stop this type of agendas or to increase the awareness in general people? So that was my question. So is there anything we can do? If yes, then what would be our role as a science researcher or student?
Yeah, good question. Actually, we should do something about it, because we do see the propagation of various unscientific beliefs and personal beliefs in the name of science. Yeah. And that those of us who have studied science definitely know that the basic fundamental thing about science is that science believes in nothing without evidence. So if that idea we can adhere to, we can ourselves analyze which of these ideas are factual, which are imagination, and which should be contradicted, and we should actively contradict those ideas. So, for example, if somebody says that there was aircraft, definitely you have to ask the evidence. Where is the evidence of a single broken piece of an aircraft that was, say, 5,000 years back? No problem, you can ask that. The point is that we often do not ask. And as I started by saying that when we studied history in our school, we were never told that the whole of the history is constructed on the basis of evidence. And we were never told which evidence led us to believe what. And therefore, since we do not get tuned to thinking that way, that is why when some idea comes, we often tend to believe, we don't question. The scientific community can question that. Scientific community can point out that there has to be evidence behind any claim, any belief, so any statement. So it is a bounden duty of those of us who have got the opportunity. We are very minority, remember that. In our country, very few people get the opportunity of studying science. Those who have got the opportunity of studying science, it is our bounden duty to oppose those cultivation of unscientific beliefs and superstition. To bring people, common people, who are deprived of studying science out of those unscientific beliefs and superstitions. We have to actively propagate scientific temper. There's another thing. Is there any question, any other question, Manavendra? Or should I go to concluding part?
Concluding part.
Yeah. Please. I would like to say in conclusion that India had a very rich history, a rich tradition in science. there are a lot of things to be proud of, but not what now are being claimed as India's contribution. India did not invent the aircraft. India did not invent a way of placing an elephant head on a human torso. India did not invent the internet and television. So these are not the contributions of India, but zero and place value system are contributions of India. In Greece, much of the development in mathematics happened in geometry because they could not develop the proper number system, convenient number system, place value system. So they could not develop much of arithmetic. They could not develop much of algebra as well as much of trigonometry. All this development happened in India. The algebra that you know, even the solution of a quadratic equation, solution of simultaneous equations, these happened in India. The solution of quadratic equation minus b plus minus b square minus 4ac by twice a, this was first stated in this subcontinent. In terms of, trigonometry. In trigonometry, you will find that whatever you study in school, sine square plus cos square equal to 1 is a trigonometric relation. That relation was first stated in India. Similarly, you will find all those trigonometric identities that you learned in school, most of these were actually developed by Bhaskaracharya, Brahmagupta. So these developments are things to be proud of. But don't be proud of what actually did not happen. Don't live under illusion. Live under reality. The reality is such that we have reasons to be proud of. But at the same time, we have to be aware that that tradition at some point died off, and died off because of some reasons. And those reasons are still alive today. So if the reasons that made science die off at one point of time, we identify that, then it becomes our bounden duty to get rid of those at modern times. So this is also something that we the scientists should do, identify those which act against the cultivation of science and remove those hurdles from the path of science so that science can go forward. The Breakthrough Science Society actually is working towards that. I will end with that. Anubhendu, you can now take over.
Yes. Okay, so thank you very much. Thank you very much. It had been a wonderful time actually, where we have learned so many things. We have cleared our doubts and also got, at least to some extent, a guidance that what we should do as science scholars or science loving people for future. So with this message from Professor Soumitra Banerjee, I would like to thank everyone, both on Zoom as well as on YouTube Live, and in particular to Professor Soumitra Banerjee for giving us this wonderful time. So thank you very much. We'll meet again in some other program. So stay in touch with us. Thank you very much. I end here. Thank you.